Welcome. I'm Gary Lasorte, Professor of Art at Valencia College. Today I'd like to introduce to you the cultural historical montage project that I've given my Drawing 1 students over a period of semesters. It's been an excellent project in terms of giving them the capability of researching a historical time frame of their own choosing. I show a variety of different DVDs and do lecturing on history over a period of time, but I allow them to choose the image that they want for this particular assignment. And it isn't an assignment, a project that basically is the culmination of the entire semester, because what it includes are the three traditional aspects of subject matter that's been utilized by the Renaissance masters, like we'll see Da Vinci today. And those subject matters are always portrait figure, landscape, and still life. And what I'll do is I'll go to the image that I've developed personally of an overview of Da Vinci and talk about the project and what's included in getting the ingredients, so to speak, together to bake the entire cake and to do the final icing so this thing comes out very, very nice, refined, and is a good, thorough research project. So let's take a look at the image that I have here on the easel, and I'll walk you through it as well, too. First, what I want to talk about is the substrate. Substrate basically is a term for whatever you're drawing, painting on, etc., whatever the surface is. It literally can be paper, it can be canvas, it can be masonite. Any number of different types of substrates can be used. In this particular image, for a particular reason, I chose a wheat paper, heavy stock to use the color pencil on. And also, if you notice, what this has is a deckled edge. So it actually has a little bit look of an antique image to begin with. And then what I did is I went through the stages that I tell my students to always do, which is preliminary thumbnails. You never want to believe that you're going to get the first best image with what you do. It's always a process. Anyone that's been in the field of art, if it's fine art or commercial for years, will tell you the situation always is the more preliminaries you do, the more likely the final piece is going to be very, very solid. So what I want to do is go through a couple of preliminaries first and talk a little bit about those with you. So the first one that I want to show you on the screen is a quick color pencil sketch that I did. And in this particular one, you'll notice that it has some of the elements of the finish, but they're not quite in the same location or same size and relationship. Also, I included quickly typed just with the name Da Vinci as well, too. In this particular piece, as we look at it, ultimately I came up with the title for it, Symphony for Leonardo. So I'm thinking about the music quality as well of the Renaissance along with the imagery that was done here. But notice what's taking place here. Like Leonardo's notebook sketches and some of his larger scale sketches, it's done in the earthen sepia tone or a burnt umber type of ink that he would also use. I'm also doing some stroke work here that is very similar to his in terms of the notebook. Da Vinci was basically left-handed from our knowledge, and so he had a particular stroke that went in a direction that we see in the notebooks time after time. So some of the elements included portrait of Da Vinci himself, you see the Mona Lisa peeking over the top, and he often did a number of different figureheads that were either Madonnas or angels where they were looking down, kind of like from the sky down in some cases or down to a figure below. And then Da Vinci was known for a tremendous amount of sketches of horses. One in particular was for a major bronze that he wanted to complete as well, too. So I've sketched that quickly, and then the hand coming down here. Also, Da Vinci, in terms of the master that he was in the Renaissance, not only known for the art, but also for those things that were very mechanical. Within the thousands of pages of notebook sketches, he literally was ahead of his time, and he was showing such things as submarines, as tanks, gear mechanisms for a car, diving equipment, a whole variety of things that basically placed him ahead of time when he lived 500 years ago. So that's the first sketch. Then what I did is I went to a graphite sketch, just quickly picked up the pencil, and I developed it a little bit different, and I went fairly circular here. You'll see some more elements of Da Vinci here. The concept idea for the helicopter was used in a number of the sketches. Da Vinci, the name here, is kind of flared out in terms of a perspective. We got directional line. The horse is maintained in here as well, too. But with the flying machines and the wing mechanisms, I decided to do something with the wing off to the side, possibly include that. Now, Da Vinci was also known for various different geometrics. And later on in the DVD, I may show you more of those as well, too. Now, the last sketch, you'll see so much closer to what we have is the final here, is I'm developing and I'm getting into a little bit more of what's known as a sfumato or the chiaroscuro, the old master terms for the play of light and dark, and developing an image a little bit more in terms of getting the feeling of volume or 3D. So with blending stump and with my finger as well too, I started to develop the image a little bit more, go a little bit stronger in terms of line technique, and utilizing Da Vinci's actual self-portrait, which was done in red chalk on paper, and copying that and getting a little bit more detail, a little bit more finesse, and a little bit more of the likeness as well too. The hand comes down and curves, so I've got this continuation, a little bit more of the circular down below. Now, I'll go to the final. Da Vinci, we should note, lived to be 67 years old. Phenomenal amount of work that was accomplished during that course of time. Born in 1452, passed away in 1519. So now let's take a look at the sketch here in terms of the refined image itself, and I'll talk a little bit more about substrate as well too. This has a texture to it. I wanted to work with a particular stock that was heavy enough to kind of take some manipulation with the color pencil, but also when you've got texture on the substrate, the surface, it grabs the pencil and it gives you an opportunity to have a little bit of broken areas as well too. You can press very hard and firm and you can fill in those recessed areas, or you can float on top and you get some breakage and you can get a little bit of texture coming through the surface. So starting on the very top, the mysterious eyes and smile of the Mona Lisa. As we look into history, probably the most recognizable group of eyes, and most people would agree about this in terms of art, would simply be looking at the eyes of the Mona Lisa. Most people can catch that gaze and understand the painting that it is in a very short amount of time. What I did was develop the image further, and I've got action marks in terms of the directional stroke, once again, in terms of Da Vinci's portrait. But here, literally, I've taken a little bit of license because Da Vinci, in his paintings, developed the chiaroscuro field, the sfumato, further with the soft blending. I've worked in a little bit more dimension in this piece than the actual red chalk sketch that Da Vinci did of himself. Also, a couple things that I want to mention as well, too. I teach portraiture in depth, and today I'd like to show some quick overview as to how to capture a likeness as well, too, later on in the time frame here. But if you take a look at Da Vinci's head here, we have a little bit of what's called reflected light in shadow. It happens under the nose as well, too. I'll take my pointer here so you can see a little bit better and follow along. So what we have is dark against light, dark against light, dark against light. The only way in drawing, painting, regardless of what your media is, to get the illusion of 3D is how you position the lights against the darks. So what I've done here, even underneath the nose, we have reflected light under the nose as well too. With this portrait, I want to mention as well too, with Da Vinci's original, the eyes basically are gazing off this way to the viewer, okay? They do not look, or they are gazing away from the viewer. They do not look directly towards you. I played a little bit artistic license here where I have the eyes actually with the ability to follow you a little bit. So Leonardo comes a little bit more to life here in terms of where you are in the image. There's a little bit of following of you as well too. Also up here with the Madonna angel type figureheads that he did, you'll see a very, very nice soft rendition that he did in terms of getting the illusion of the flesh and also reflected light along here in the bottom of the chin. It adds to the 3D as well too. And as long as I'm on the top here, I'll make reference to the fact that with his engineering drawings, this is one for a helicopter, and so many other different things were done, as I mentioned, the sub, the tank, etc. But this is drawn basically to look like the sketches that were done in his notebooks. Then here, in terms of a transition that's taking place, what I've got is the Mona Lisa in a little bit of terms of mystery. She's disguised here, and I've got action strokes that kind of broaden out as we come down here, and purposely the action marks are coming down to the head of Da Vinci, drawing the viewer's attention down here as well too, coming behind the helicopter device. And of course we have the Madonna figurehead that also is looking down this way to Da Vinci, the Renaissance master. Then what we have in terms of the very often utilized horse images that he did in the notebooks, and ultimately Da Vinci had a large-scale project that he wanted to do as a horse bronze that would take tons and tons of bronze to complete. It was never completed in his lifetime. But the horse was a subject that he returned to time after time when he did battle scenes, or he'd just simply do something for the notebooks to understand the movement of various creatures in nature. He was very much attuned to nature, to landscape, to the movement of the clouds, and that'll bring us down to another portion of the image as well, too. Here, what we have is a rotation. We have a sense of energy held by one of the actual drawings of Da Vinci's model's hands. And this was seen time after time in the sketches where Da Vinci would do the motion of cloud, or it would be the motion of the rolling of the waves as well too. In this case, it could possibly be as well too, very symbolic and very simplified, because he did very intense study of the human body, including actually the womb as well too. So it does have just a little bit indication of creation down here as well too, in a womb formation. I've taken artistic license in terms of how I've actually combined the images myself in this particular composition, and I actually, for reasons of just balancing out the composition from the top all the way to the bottom of the page, I've extended Mr. Da Vinci's beard a little bit farther than what the actual sketch is. So what I have here is what is called a montage, a multiple image vignette. So we have the portrait figure, we have still life, we have landscape involved, we have directional strokes for energy, and then we have the vignette where there are areas where it just fades right off into the back stock of the paper. So it gives it a chance to kind of breathe and maybe resonate and maybe have more of a sense of energy, as opposed to doing a composition where you literally work and finish everything edge to edge. So it has a sensibility of a little bit of float. I find that very enjoyable. I like to work on color stock myself. And when we go to the drawing segment, I'm going to work once again on the colored wheat paper, and I'm going to do a series of drawings. I'm going to show you some of the horse art that Da Vinci did, do some renderings of horses myself, build a composition on the page, and also I'd like to take a segment and specifically do a portrait and show you how to structure a portrait, get proper proportions, and what to do in terms of starting to manipulate the skin so that you get the illusion of soft flesh, the chiaroscuro, the modeling as well too. So join me in the next segment, and we'll just do a nice overview of the drawing techniques of Leonardo da Vinci. See you there. In this segment, what I'd like to do is take you to the board and show you some of the reference that I used to construct my particular montage vignette for the Da Vinci drawing. So as we look over here to my left, to the board, I want to point out just some of the reference and just cover a few things about that. So as we look up here, you can see what I've done is one of my references was one of Da Vinci's oil sketches here that was done for the Madonna type figurehead. And you can see once again how strong the sepia, the brown tone that was utilized by Da Vinci and many of the old masters in the time of the Renaissance and elsewhere during the course of art history. Then over here to the left of that, this is a preliminary sketch that he did, one of several, and you can see again on his notebook pages or reference pages, multiple images oftentimes will be done. Some are very outstanding, some may soften off to the side when we talk about the vignette, this is what's going on. Specific and then getting general in some areas, leaving off some parts and doing a little bit more detail specific on particular things. So this is one of his sketches for the bronze horse. In the center of the board, some consider this to be the most famous drawing in the world, Vitruvian Man, by Da Vinci. As many people are aware, what it shows is the format in terms of a square, but also a circle, and then the multiple movement in terms of the joint structure of the individual. Da Vinci, like Michelangelo, did a tremendous amount of figure drawing study, and actually he and Michelangelo were known to dissect and look at cadavers, and that's what you see in many of his notebooks, is a very, very medical, precise investigation, I would say, of the human form. Over here, representation of the actual notebook in his writing, and he would write from, they believe, certainly from the right to the left. Some say it was done for secretive purposes, so people would not know exactly what he was doing when he was involved in military production for different individuals in the court, etc. And some say simply because he was left-handed, that was easier for him to do the writing in that direction. Notice, as I showed in the initial piece of my montage, the directional strokes here behind the helicopter situation. And I duplicated in that in my work as well, too. When we talk about the chiaroscuro for Da Vinci or others in the course of history, you see it in Rembrandt and so many others as well, too. Chiaroscuro is the strong play of light and dark on still life. It could be figure, it actually could be objects in the landscape. But with the chiaroscuro, what takes place is the dimension comes forward in terms of the play of light and dark. So you're not only doing preliminary loose sketching, but then you're tightening up and you're really working to get the sensation of what that particular object is. And you can see even here in the knuckles, fingernails, etc., very, very detailed. And once again, if you look closely, I talked about in the first segment, the reflected light. So as we take a look at the thumb and we take a look at some of the fingers as well too, you're seeing light within shadow. What that does is it keeps the piece from going completely flat and it gives it dimension even when it's in a shadow area. Down here on the lower left-hand side, Da Vinci, like so many other masters and everyone today that's in an academic setting, schools, fabric study to understand fabric, and basically what you're looking at is peaks and valleys. It's almost like the fabric itself to some degree is a landscape as well too. So you're looking to structure different value tones to play a light against dark, and I'll show you a value scale here in a minute as well too. But getting the illusion of 3D, this is the magic and this is the kind of special thing that you capture in terms of art when you're doing traditional art, and that is getting the illusion of something through three-dimensional on a two-dimensional surface, making it rise off of the surface. In my final piece of artwork, I showed you in the lower portion of it that there were these circular movements and motions. We see a sample here in Da Vinci's drawings where he would utilize that once again to show nature in terms of it could be rolling waves, but it could also be sky in terms of the movement of the clouds, the sensation, intensity of weather as well too. Da Vinci studied and basically was an artist that gave us an overview of all of nature, of all humankind, so to speak, during the course of his adventure for the 67 years that he was on the face of the earth. There are so many other different things that we could see in his notebooks, just multiple images, but I want to go ahead and now address here on the drawing board some other substrates and talk about the value scale as well too, and the difference between working with traditional graphite, which would be your black and white media, and it can be number two pencils, ebony, 6B, which are soft pencils, or it can be the more waxy type of colored pencil that's a little bit harder to erase, but certainly gives you some very special effects that you're not going to get with the traditional graphite type of pencil. So as we go here now to the board, I want to cover a little information quickly for anyone doing this project, because what I want you to see is we are dealing always with a value scale. This scale is normally either rated between 1 and 10 or 1 and 11. And what it is, as you look at this, is going from a pure white to a very solid black, dark, deep, rich value tone. And when you're working down here on this end, for instance, I'll grab a number two pencil just to show you that because I've done it over here in this segment too. The good old HB number two that everybody has worked with from very early on in their life, cross-hatching techniques, keeps a line very well, etc. It will give you some degree of darkness. As you go up from the HB, we're going harder. There's 2H, 4H, 6H, in 9H, which you probably can barely see on the camera, but the 9H is so hard, it will actually scribe. If this were the edge of your paper, I'm showing you here, the pencil would actually scribe down into the paper itself in a relief format. Then as we go beyond the standard middle range, good old number two, we're going softer as we move to the right. 2B, 4B, 6B, is very similar to an ebony, which I also hold right here in my hand, and I'm going to show you the advantage of an ebony, which is immediately a very dark, rich black. So the pencils themselves, when you draw, you're literally, if you have a range, working like an artist would when you're dealing with brushes. There's very small detail liner brushes, there's round heads, flat heads, brights, etc. They all do something different and special, from detailing all the way up to very broad strokes. So, with your pencils, understand they're like brushes. Once you get acquainted with them, you can make them do what you want them to do in terms of the value tone, in terms of the degree of crispness of an edge, how crisp it is when you're laying down a line, as opposed to a nice, soft, blurry edge here. And I'll show you another instrument, which is your blending stump. And when you use a softer lead, very easily you can move that graphite on the paper and you can soften areas very nicely for blending of skin, or it might be clouds in the sky, etc. So, using the tools of the trade of hard and soft pencils, in color pencils as well too, you have various different ranges of pencils that you can purchase and will do certain things for you. What I have here in the studio is Prismacolor. It's a standard, excellent color pencil. It's light, fast, or archival, meaning it will not fade under sunlight or interior light as well too. It's considered archival, museum quality. You can get them in what's called a Verathin, which will be down in the range of the harder surface, or you can get them in mid-range that will be softer, around like the 4B, 2B. They also make very wide sticks for landscape that will be more, even softer than an ebony, to get large, broad areas as you work. So you get acquainted with what the color pencils will do too. One of the best ways in terms of learning is simply get that pencil to your substrate. Understand there are different substrates, they'll act different ways. So that's the next thing I want to show you. We'll put the value scale off to the side. And it's a good practice to just try to do a value scale from 1 to 10 or 1 to 11 and show the subtle increments. Because if you can do this, you can more readily look what you need to have in your drawing or even in your painting if you're dealing with color as well too, and get the proper ranges to get the illusion of the 3D form. Now, I'll go to a few different substrates and talk about these. This, of course, is the wheat paper that I used for my final Da Vinci piece, and it's a fair amount of weight, which means you can work into it, you can erase into it. It's got some tooth to the surface, as I showed in the first segment. It will show some texture. This actually is a piece of mat board, and you can get them in all different colors, and illustration board as well, too. If you look closely at this, this is all done in what's called a gouache, which is basically a type of watercolor that's a little bit more opaque. This chose it for the same reason as I did the Da Vinci piece. And I've got another line that I'll show you in terms of full body as well, too. So what I've done is taken a variety of reference photos of wildlife myself and then used these for purposes for doing preliminary sketches, final paintings. But this is very, very nice because it actually has a marble type look to it before you even paint or draw on it. And you can get some of that base color filtering through in your image. You can get a variety of stocks of paper that literally will look like stone, granite, marble, etc. And so that comes into play because you get the filtration of the background, which can make your drawing very, very nice and interesting as well too. Now let me show you the full size image here of the lion. Now what I've chosen here is a gray, staying away from the pure white once again, and let me just show you the contrast when we look at a pure white as well too. Gray stock, okay, pure white, everybody's familiar with using the pure white. This already gives you, when we look at the value scale, a mid-range tone value to work on. And so in some ways you're working in the reverse. And what I mean by that is, I'll come over here and I'll grab one of my white color pencils, is when I did this and I start to lay it out, you can see it here, okay, and I'll even remark here and maybe make some of these areas a little bit stronger, is the light will pop out from the background that you have. And even if you do directional strokes, let me do a little stroke here, just another highlight on the muscle as well too. What's taking place is the reverse. You've got a mid-range gray, you're pulling the whites out here. Same way if I came over here to the main and I want to overemphasize here, what I'm doing is I'm giving the opportunity to detail with a white pencil on a toned background. I can go a little bit stronger down here as we get into the paw area as well too. And you can see what I'm doing is I'm pulling the lights out. I'm pulling the form out of the page, working a little magic, a little illusion, going kind of 3D here with this. And it just works very nicely. Whenever I work with any of my students, I bring the color stock into the room, different color papers. They might be earthen tones browns, or they might be grays, or my students may specifically want to purchase something themselves. Everybody just gets a lift in terms of what takes place as soon as they get these pencils to this particular paper stock, because the magic happens in a way that it doesn't happen on just a white stock of paper. Also, take a look too. You can see here the way I drew the color pencil behind here, you will see the break in the color. Broken color because there's enough texture on this board. As I take a paint, oh, let's see. I'll reach over and I'll just grab one of these color pencils here and I'll do it up here as well too. Rather than just working always on the edge with a straight solid line, you can also move off to the side this way, okay? And you can work your leads this way and pull them off to the side and show some of the detail of some of the texture that's underlying there as well too. So that's what we have going in this piece. Then, what I've shown you here between the various different pieces were all warm in terms of the color wheel. Analogous color on the color wheel is color that's closely related. So in other words, you can have yellow, ochre, burnt umber, raw sienna, etc. The brown tones, the earthen tones, which is what we see with a lot of the old master work. Then the other option is you can go to the cooler aspect of the color wheel, so you can work in your blues, your greens, your purples, etc. What I want to show you here now is specifically a choice difference between the warm environment that we saw for the lions. Obviously, you're talking about Africa, you're talking about heat of the sun, maybe desert regions, etc. Now, we're looking at the polar bear. What's the wise thing that we're doing? Choosing a stock, and I will show you the stock from the back without anything on it so you can see what it is. The stock from the back basically is a gray or a blue-gray, okay? So once again, what I've done is the sensibility is cold climate. So I want to go to a cold, cool base to begin with. Logical. You're thinking this thing through on purpose. And then once again, since the polar bear for the most part is, it's considered white, but it's really off-white, yellow. Coloration can change during the course of the year as well too. But I'm going in and once again, I'm working the area and actually drawing and structuring this, starting with larger shape. When you work, be it wildlife or you're doing a portrait, whatever you happen to be doing, what I do and I always teach in the portrait classes, look for the largest shape, ovals, etc., cylinders, various different geometric shapes that might be in an object, work from the large area and shape and then get in the details. So you stay loose and later in a segment I'm actually going to show you a Da Vinci portrait, recopy the Da Vinci portrait and show you how to work the proportion and get a likeness and get similar line quality to Da Vinci as well too. So, makes sense, cool paper stock, cool environment. Right away what you're doing is selectivity here where we've got in the montage format, larger figurehead, secondary whole image of the polar bear, we've got a seal in the background, and so we've got environment working all the way throughout the composition as well too. This piece is edge to edge. Unlike the vignette, what I did with the polar bears and I did with the lion, I worked everything right out to the edge. So you can have selectivity in terms of what you might do with a vignette, or you can work edge to edge if you're so inclined. Next thing I'd like to do, when we look at Da Vinci, as I mentioned in the first segment as well too, Da Vinci is known for having done a tremendous amount of sketching in terms of his individual investigation. Here is a whole page of horses, and this is similar to what I'm going to do for you today. I'm going to work in the earthen tones, the sepia or burnt umber. A lot of times he worked in brown ink, but also in the chalks. His self-portrait, as I mentioned earlier, was actually done in a red chalk. There's some disintegration and problems with that. After about 500 years, there's some breaking down of that. And unfortunately, just to give you a little history on Da Vinci, some of the pieces that he did, of course, he didn't have the full knowledge of the chemistry that we have today, but he did make some mistakes occasionally in what he did with experimentation. The most dramatic aspect of that happening in his life was the Last Supper, which just about everybody is familiar with. What he did was he painted it on a wall, and it was susceptible to a couple different things. He combined tempera, which is water-based, with oil, which is oil-based. Water and tempera chemically don't mix. Within 6 years of doing that masterpiece, it started to break down. Plus, it was done on a wall where there was dampness, so it had several different things that were working against it and starting to disintegrate it. In terms of the Mona Lisa, one of the most famous portraits on the face of the earth, that was done on a wooden board. Oftentimes, he would work on different substrates, but that was done on a wooden board. Heavy glazes with Mona, one of the things that they found out is there are 30 different layers of glaze of oil paint on that, which means if you think about a glaze like stained glass, you have light coming through and basically passing through glaze after glaze after glaze, and this is how he gets that very, very soft rendition of just the curvature of the face, or it could be the arm, or it could be the fabric. So he's building that up. Some people believe, I wasn't there so I can't verify it for a fact, that some of the brushes were only one or two hairs in terms of what he was using to do some of the detailing on that. It has cracked. It is protected under bulletproof glass now over in the Louvre, but it has cracked, and there's a lot of breakdown because of all the glazes as well too. It doesn't flex because it's a hard surface. Had it been on canvas, it might even be in tougher condition than it is. But artists in the past did not always know what was taking place in terms of their particular reaction between the substrate and the particular types of paints that they might be using. Okay, let's move on to a little bit more in terms of what I want to show with him in the way of horses as well too. This is, as we see on the board there, and I've got it on the tabletop as well too, this is the study for the bronze sculpture of the horse. And what I want to do is do a little bit of Da Vinci work in the horse and talk about some shapes and how to get a likeness as well too, and compose a page like what I just showed you in terms of Da Vinci's own drawing as well too. I'm going to show you some of my own particular horse sketches here. And this one, let me put this down here. This is the opposite direction. Later on, not too long ago in history, they were able to do the bronze horse that Da Vinci himself wanted to be structured. Tremendous amount of bronze, and some people believed if Da Vinci had the time, he may not have actually had the resources in his lifetime to cast this bronze horse because of the scope and scale and the amount of bronze that was involved in this as well too. This is one of the things about Da Vinci I so love about the man. He was trapped in his particular point in time in history. When we talk about cultural, historical, we're going back about 500 years. So here's a man that's doing sketches in his notebooks, and he's doing the helicopter, the submarine. He's doing gear mechanisms for a propelled car. He's working on things in terms of hydraulics and bridges and diving equipment, but he does not have, because he's locked back in history, he doesn't have aluminum, he doesn't have computers, he doesn't have resins, he doesn't have certain types of plastics. The man has this tremendous genius, but it's limited. So it's not until we move through the ages and the door opens more and more that people go, Da Vinci was far, far beyond his years in history. And this is one of the reasons I chose that man and that time frame in terms of depicting that image for you. It's just so phenomenal and renowned that somebody was able to capture all the things of the world and be able to pull out so much out of his own recognition of the world and apply that into his inventions, etc. So what I want to do is just show you quickly a series of sketches that I've done with horses as well too. When you sketch, okay, the more you draw, the looser you'll get as well too. These are done in pen and ink, and a lot of times I'll challenge myself in pen and ink because I cannot erase it. When these are down on the page, they're down on the page. So it's like a one-shot deal, and it forces me to get the rendering fairly accurate as well too. So like Da Vinci, what I like is the drama, the intensity, the strength of the horse, and that's what I'm showing in these. So I will do partial shots, I will do the vignette type of situation, I'll detail a little bit more in terms of perhaps shadow, value tone. Love the horse because of the flow of the mane. The strength is there just in terms of the movement of the body, but when you look at the mane, when you look at the tail, and here in the profile as well too, the head of the horse is just so regal. There's no reason why you can't see why artists throughout history have chosen the horse and chosen the horse to depict so many different times in so many different ways. Just a few more sketches here, and then I'll start the drawing as well too. So action, poses as well too. Notice too, in terms of when I talk about dynamics in a composition, even it's one single image, as opposed to being straight up and down, I'll choose poses that angle this way. Da Vinci has done the same thing in terms of his drawing as well too. We've got more drama. The idea here of the horse on the run, static this way, as soon as you tilt, there's more of a sense of energy about that as well too. Take a look at this one. And I'll actually show you with the pencil. What I see is happening here is, if you follow just the back line on this, here's the motion here. We've got a rhythm that's taking place in the back of the horse, just like this. Without doing any detail, this is what's going on. The strength of the horse this way, pull down this way, okay? So we've got this, almost as if you thought sound waves, okay? There's a movement, there's a strength about this. So the movement this way, then what do we have here when we get down to the legs? We've got a stability with it. Staying loose with the mane, doing some line work like Da Vinci does just to indicate the belly of the horse. And when you draw too, if something is round, think of working in terms of drawing the line in the direction of what it is, because what you're doing to the viewer, just with line itself, without any blending, you're communicating this is curved, this has a cylinder effect to it. So your line quality itself is going to communicate in the language of art to your viewer about the volume, the 3D, the mass of what the object is as well too. So several different ones. When you do preliminaries, now you saw some that are a little more detailed. This will be the last one, I'll move on. But I just want to show you, this is an option that I might eventually do as a painting. Look at how simple this is, but what's going on here? And I'll take the pencil and I'll redraw some of the things too. What I have is the horses here, and I'll just outline that a little bit stronger, okay? They are, in my mind, is I've got a communication between the two, and the thought line here is I'm going to have these running through waves at the edge of the ocean. So what I've got here is the horses communicating visually between one another, and in composition, you can also balance the composition just in terms of direction of eye, and communicating out to the viewer, off to the side, or between various different subjects in the composition. Then down here, what I'm doing is I'm doing nothing more than I'm just communicating very softly to myself that I'm going to have some waves, or basically at the edge of the waves here. Now with Da Vinci, what he might do is you might get some of the circular motion that you see on the board as well too, when he's doing waves and he's communicating movement of the energy of the sky as well too. So I can just continue to do this. But all the lines have something to do with interacting with one another. Composition, here's the simple way to look at composition. As soon as you take a substrate and you put a mark on it, you started to create a composition. Complex? No, but you've got a composition. Put a mark anywhere on the page, brushstroke, composition has begun. Then it's what you're going to do with the composition. Compositions too come in a variety of different ways. You can have a radial composition where everything is centralized like a radial tire or a daisy, and it all equally comes out from the center and moves out and balances that way. You can have symmetrical composition where what you do is you equally divide your page and everything is balanced side to side. It could actually be a mirror image. So whatever is happening this way, I could have a horse head that moves out this way to the left and one that equally balances it, mirrors it to the right as well too. So that basically is a very symmetrical composition. This is asymmetrical. It's balanced. I have a horse here. They're not identical. I have energy and different things that are happening on both sides of the page, but there's more flexibility. For the most part, usually in art, an asymmetrical composition is usually considered the most creative, oftentimes. You can get very creative with the others, but you have more to do in terms of structuring and balance when you work with the asymmetrical composition. So here we are, possibility of a painting. I've got file cabinets that I have of images that I'll do drawings, I'll set them aside, and I may not know exactly when I'll get to the painting, or this could be part of another composition that may go even larger. For instance, when you're doing a composition, this could be it in what's known as the landscape fashion, or you could go portrait, which is going to elevate it this way. Well, I could have the rolling waves and the sparkle here and sand texture here as well too, but then I could decide, hey, I want to do it at sunrise or sunset, and I want the drama up above of the rays of the sun coming down and hitting the back of the horses here, sparkling here, maybe a little bit of a light cast shadow on the waves. So I come all the way up, maybe twice the width of this or more, and we've got the drama of that dawn, or basically that sunset, the sun coming through and the rays coming right down below. All kinds of selections that can be made. The other thing that I'll do, just to let you know in terms of composition, when I'm doing things as well too, I'll pull back to this page, is I may look at something and I decide I want to use this in conjunction with something else in the composition. Easily enough, I'll just fold it. Sometimes I'll just toss it on the copier or make a scan, enlarge it, reduce it, and then just place things on my board to see how that's going to work. Don't ever, once again, believe that the first composition you structure, that you create, is going to be the best solution. Rare does it ever happen. That's one of the reasons for all the preliminaries, and then you have more selection to make as you assemble this all together as well too. Okay, let's take a look. We'll go back to Mr. Da Vinci. And what I want to do is just show you some loose pencil rendering. And again, I'm going to stay within the earthen tone. So as we take a look here at the board itself and see what my reference is, staying loose with this. And you can start even if you want to go a little bit lighter. And what I've got here is more like an ochre color. And as I go darker, you're going to see it on the screen better, because I can go from an ochre, then I can go into like a raw sienna, red sienna, and right into a burnt umber. But if I start here, notice too, even Da Vinci, what he's done, I'll start off to the side, very loosely what he's doing is he's sketching in the ears. They're not there real dark, but you can see them, and he's got a little bit wisp of the mane in the front. A lot of times with the mane of the horse, it's going to flow in the front. Then what do we have here? We've got curvature of the neck. Great thing about the horse, tremendous strength in terms of that look of the neck. So I'm just pulling that back, just like the sketch there. The angle here, in terms of the front of the horse, looking and duplicating that. If you rolled your pencil right over here, this would give you a good indication as to what's happening in terms of the angle of that as well too. We've got a little injection here of where the eye area is going to be. Come down here, and we're going to see the structure here as we come down here for the nose into the mouth. And the mouth, there's some drama to the mouth as well too. It's partially open. What Da Vinci did in a number of his studies was literally look at the horse in depth and look at what's taking place even with the teeth in the horse's mouth and how that sets up. Again, when he's going back and he's doing all of these preliminary studies in the morgue and he's looking and examining human figure, etc., he brings that into the natural world in terms of the horse as well too. So just loose sketch, okay? I can alter that if I need to. If I say, okay, proportion looks right, size of the ears, I like the angle here, indicated the nose here as well too. We've got some sense of gesture of the mouth. And you'll see too, what he's doing here is periodically, he's selecting some of the other individual recessed areas on the horse that specifically show more of the form as well too. When we get up here, here's that little indicator line here, we've got the eye here, and we're coming in, notice the distance between the edge here, coming into the eye here. You can always adjust, but I'm just roughing that in. I haven't gone real dark yet, so if I had to alter and I had to erase, go ahead and erase. So here it is laid in this way, and with Da Vinci, he's kept the mane fairly close to the head. And a lot of horses, different breeds, what people have done through history sometimes is crop the mane, sometimes it's actually braided as well too. So we're just coming down this way. So again, the slope situation, look at what's happening. I'll do the outline once again, just for some rhythm, the slope here. Now let's take a look at where this neck area is coming here. It's coming up above, starting in where the eye is here. So if I brought that down through as a reference point here, and then here, positive, negative space. Positive is the horse, negative is the air space around it. When you draw, don't only just draw the object, think about the negative space. And I have my students do an assignment with positive, negative space as well too. So the distance between these two areas as we come down this way as well too. So there's some drama here if you decide you have to readjust in terms of what's happening with the area of the back main area here, coming down here, do so. Look at some of the line work that takes place here. I'm just going to drop that in. Notice underneath here, he's drawn this jaw area here, and he's a little bit stronger in terms of what's happening with the shadow. Line weight, going from thick to thin, a thicker line itself can communicate shadow just by going a little bit heavier. And even though it's light on the screen, I just took a quick look, you can see that in terms of what I'm doing there. He even gets a little bit more of a shadow underneath here, so he pulls in this way. Then, folds of the skin. So just the way we have knuckles, you see the skin folds, etc. Depending on the horse, you're going to get different folds as well too. There's different types of sheens that might be on a horse as well too. So I'm coming down this way with that. And then we've got, I'll come down this far and I'll just do a little rhythm back this way with this figurehead. Coming back here. And what I'm going to do, once again, the fold areas that are seen here, and they get a little bit deeper in terms of the crevices are underneath that jaw area. He also has these crevice areas that are back here. He's investigating, what does the horse do? What takes place with the skin? What sets this animal apart from other animals? Why does it have the sense of form and strength that it does? He's dealing with muscle structure in here as well too. We've got a little bit of softness of shadow in here, just a little bit of line work like this. I can take my blending stump and I can use that as well too as we move along. Up here, a little bit stronger in terms of a shadow area on the mane, so I'm just going to knock that in a little bit stronger as well too. And then here, just to show a little bit more in terms of shadow area, maybe a little more flyaway. What I'm doing is kind of limiting my own flair for how I do horses simply because this mane's a little more cropped. I like to do something maybe a little bit more flowing as well too. We can continue down here. I want to use the whole page, so what I'm going to do is just kind of block this thing in here, and what he's got is part of the leg coming in here. Even in part of this horse, you start to see the strength. And here, oftentimes it's interesting with the horse, as you look at the muscle in the front, when you see it straight on and depending on how they're flexing, it almost looks like an inverted heart. So you look for shapes within shapes as well too. So some of the form, I'm just going to knock in here a little bit more as well too. I'll come back, I'll do a little bit of the back area here, and I may overlap some other things on top of this as I'm working along. So what I'm going to do is just sit, take this one, set it aside a little bit. Now as a balance, I talked about folding. I'm going to take one of my sketches, and I like the drama of this one out of the series that I have here as well too, and I'm going to do basically the same thing here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take, and I'm going to, from the back of this one, just to see if it's going to be interesting, and I'll do it light, you can always adjust later, is I'm going to move here and do some gesture drawing with the flow of the mane this way off of this horse, right into the back. There's kind of a flow that happens here with the crevices here. It may or may not work, but again, you're just sketching light. You can always resketch as well too, but you're doing exploration. Ears here, kicked back on each side. This one rides a little bit higher. If we were to make a mark across here, notice that the ear on this side rides a little bit higher. So I'm just doing a comparison, proportion, and height of different things from one part of the animal to the other. Then what takes place here, this great little flyaway hair. Look what's going on here. We've got this drama here, talking about a good hair day. Here's a great hair day right here for a horse. Okay, so you're looking at good hair day on a horse. The drama this way. Notice where, when we talk about the angle area here of the jawline, we're dealing with the jawline again. Notice where this comes in relationship to the ear there. So I'm just going to come down here, I'm going to kick it in a little bit, and then notice the angle. Just the way I talked about the angle here, let's take a look at angles here on the horse here. So I'm noticing that this hair is kicked out here, but the front of the horse is angled out a little bit from where that ear is. We got a similar direction. And what's taking place here, I'm going to pull it right down here and then I'll make adjustments, is we've got a little bit of a flare that comes out here when we get down to the nostril area. And just kind of rough in where the nostril may be going there. And again, the open mouth of the horse this way, there's a recessed area, which means we're a little bit further back into the mouth there, you might show maybe possible little bit of teeth or something in there, make an adjustment for the length of the snout. And then we've got the underlying jaw here as well too. So this is taking place with the eyes now. They're kind of falling a little bit underneath where this mane is flowing here. So I want to come in here. You can sketch across this way. Notice with the horse, when you're dealing with an eye or a socket on the side, if you're doing three quarters or from above, you're going to get a little bit of that angle there. Then we're going to come back here. I did a directional line, again, to roughen where this thing is going to go. And we've got the eye looking down, closed a little bit more. We got side of the eye here. This one's closed a little bit more, okay? And we can come out and we can widen that a little bit if we want as well, too. So I got the basic structure in, a few lines here, underneath here. We've got a few lines that are above the eye socket as well, too, for the horse here. I think I'll strengthen the width of the jaw area up here. So we've got this taking place between the two. And I think what I'll do is go ahead and bring that mane up just a little bit more in terms of drama. So I'm looking at motion this way, tying in the two this way. I'm going to bring this down further this way on the page. And what I'll do here as you look at this horse is we've got another leg off of this one. And again, take a look at the muscle here. Even though there's not much showing, just with this increase here, you start to feel the strength of the muscle of that leg. So I'm just going to bring that in here. We'll have some shadow area that comes in here as well too. And so between the two of them, it's interesting. We got two different views, larger here, smaller here, profile. You know, we're looking a little bit more above here. So just in terms of the shape on the page, is it interesting? Do I want to continue with that? It's a possibility. I can also change in terms of what you focus on. As I tighten this up with a darker pencil, I can make you look at the areas I want you to, because wherever you have the area of greatest contrast, the play of light and dark is where your eye is going to be drawn to. On the scale, once again, when I have that lower gray scale and we're looking at pure white, light grays, there's not much contrast there between the first couple of segments of the value scale. So it's kind of, it's soft, you know, it's kind of basically a high key, it's referred to. If I took a pure white against a solid black, obviously there's a tremendous amount of contrast and things pop out greater. So as you look at your value scale, you can push and pull, you can play with the depth and the perspective by what you do with value alone. You can direct and lead the viewer to see where the detailing is. What's known, as I refer to oftentimes, general specific. Where you get very generalized, it's there, your eye can wander around the page, then you get specific and detailed in certain areas as you work that as well too. And I'm just going to take a look through my studies here. Let's see what else looks good. Here, since we're dealing with close-up views, maybe I'll do one more as well too as we move across the page this way. Now what I've done, and I'm just going to fold this to get the rest of the image out of the way here, and I'll just do another one down below here. Check my pencil. I've got an electric pencil sharpener. When you're dealing with color pencil, just to let you know, a lot of times if you're dealing with a softer pencil, they're going to go down quicker than if you've got a harder lead. You can hand sharpen them, and I have a good old hand sharpener here as well too that you can use, or you can get and invest in a basically an electric pencil sharpener or a pencil sharpener that might be battery operated. So nice, quick, beautiful point in just a short amount of time. So what do I want to do down here? This horse kind of has a directional look below. We've got this one out this way. So I think what I'll do in thinking in terms of positive, negative space, I'm just going to kind of rough this in here and maybe drop it down a little bit lower so we have a little directional line here, working to fill the page. And now I'm thinking, I've got ears here. Where do I have to go with the size of this horse so I can fit the ears in there in terms of the composition? The head, once again, is coming down this way, and I want to keep it to a size where it's going to stay on the page. So I'm basically configuring the size of this horse so that it's going to maintain some space on the page. So playing around with the composition a little bit, and then I'm going to make a decision what should be actually the size of this horse's head to make it work in the composition this way. So we've got some looseness once again, some flyaways in terms of the main. And I think to balance out what I've done here in this direction, I think I'm really gonna let these flow back this way off of the main. So we're gonna have that tremendous strength of the neck tip down. If we took arrows, we'd literally draw arrows like this. This one's going this way, this one's going this way. So we get some drama going this way off the back of the neck. And you'll see here what I've done is I've just designated a little more indication here of the volume of the horse, some of the strength of the neck, just with the strokes. Da Vinci's doing the same thing in his notebooks with individual strokes and looking at what takes place in terms of minimal line, but getting some degree of perhaps maximum indication of the form as well too. Pulling this one back here where you can see it as well too. So I'm looking here on the angle here. I've got an eye that basically is going to be here, the ear area up above, and then we're gonna have the snout down here as well too. And this will curve in as well. And I've just got some action marks here as well. When I get under here, if you take a look at this, I've talked about reflected light within shadow. I'm gonna have a deeper shadow underneath here, the jawline of the horse. And so I'll indicate something here, but in this white area, and I can actually use my white pencil on this to pull it out as I develop the image, is I can get some nice reflected light underneath. And what that does is it gives you more dimension and sense of three-dimensional look, even in that shadow area. Get a little snout area going here as well too. And we'll do some refinement on that as well too. So I'll just make it into the page. If it is matted or frame, yeah, we got a little bit of a live area as well too. What I always tell my students, when you're going to do a drawing, when you're going to frame or whatever like that, anything important, try to keep it in at least a quarter inch or a half inch from the edge of the paper. Now, with deckled edge, which this page has, and you could actually rip the bottom and top if you started from scratch before you did your drawing to get the deckled edge all the way around. With a deckled edge, when artists frame, sometimes what they'll do is what's called a float frame. And that is, you're taking the substrate, your paper, and you're putting it on a heavier board, and then you put it under glass, plexiglass, or whatever. You're not bringing a mat up to it. It's just floating on a mat underneath. So if you should do a drawing where it goes all the way out to the edge, and you got something important out on the edge, and you don't want to lose it, float it in the frame, then you're going to see 100%. It doesn't matter. And there are techniques, archival tacking techniques and taping techniques, where it'll be placed on a board and it's going to be good and secure as well too. Archival, a terminology, just in terms of some art history. What took place years and years ago, the museums throughout the world had to go and reframe a number of pieces of art because when they did the matting that they used at the time, the paper substance, was acidic. It had acid in it. And gradually, the acid from those mats started to move into the substrate paper and discolor it. So museums had to hop on the bus pretty quick worldwide and reframe all those so they weren't destroying the original drawing underneath. Now, even matting is very archival. Everything's been chemically tested, so it'll last for years and years and preserve the drawing as well too. Okay, so these three laid in sometimes in terms of doing a triad, it's kind of nice just to have three things. But look what's going on the page. Okay, we got this V formation here, kind of interesting because in a way it's somewhat like a mirror effect. We're coming down the two legs here, but we're moving across the page this way. We have energy that's taking place here, energy that's taking place there. Now, let me just go in and I'm going to move up next stage just in terms of what I do with a, let's say, like a raw sienna pencil, which is a little bit darker. So you're going to start to see it pop out a little bit more, and you can see the contrast on this, although it's black and white as well, too. So as soon as I come in here and I start to introduce the darker pencil, see, the form is starting to pop. And I can leave little secondary areas again. Remember what I said. Darker contrast, it's going to move forward. If I leave this light, it stays in the background. So I can play here. I can do a little bit more volume and detailing, flyaways here. And I'll be consistent with what Leonardo has done here with the back of the horse. Now, notice, as I get back here, see how dark this area is here with the horse. So I'm going to do a very similar type of thing. is I'm just going to work in a more dramatic cast shadow area here. And we have those folds once again as well too. Let's just go and emphasize the mane a little bit more, keeping with some of Leonardo's strokes this way. Notice how this comes and wraps around the ear, the base of the ear, because sometimes you will actually have the hair from the mane that will wrap around the base of the ear. And that's what Leonardo has observed. That's what I'm doing here. Then I'm coming down here for a shadow area and basically coming into where the eye is here. And notice, cast shadow area here, a little bit heavier in that area when you're talking about doing the recessed area around the socket. And we'll come down here and we'll emphasize a little bit more. I could actually put a little pupil area in there. I may come back and do that as well too. So coming down here, down the snoot, and I'm going to go and I'm going to recess a little bit more into the nostril area on that horse. He's got some line work that's taking place this way, wraps down here. And so what I'm doing, if I want to reconfigure a line now that I'm going darker, feel free to reconfigure, draw it a little bit farther out if that's going to work for you. And I want to keep similar to what he has, just in terms of the character, the gesture of the mouth here as well too. I like kind of what's going on there. Okay, the angle here, coming up here, he's got an additional line that's under here. Again, in here, if I painted this, I would use reflected light under the jaw here, the way I talked about the other one as well too. So we're coming up on an angle here. Let's go a little bit stronger with the jaw area now. And then we get up here into the neck. We've got things laid out. You can feel a little bit more comfortable about what you're doing as you strengthen this drawing. Now, okay, coming down this way, we'll go and we'll recess a little bit deeper in terms of these folds under the neck. This would be a nice area for reflected light as well too. The area under here, but also here. So if I were to deepen the shadow area here, this area right down through here could be reflected light and make it kind of interesting and pop the form a little bit more. So I'm coming down here and what I'm going to do is a little bit deeper recessed line here. And also work in deeper shadow area, excuse me, into the leg area of the horse. And you'll see some of the strength here in terms of the muscle area that's above these chest muscles that's coming down here. So I'm just going to draw in a little bit of that and some additional line here. This comes all the way up through here. Then the strength here, the front of this muscle, and Leonardo's given that heavier definition with a stronger line there. So I'm just gonna follow his layout, so to speak. We've got lighter line work in the back here, some recessed area. Okay, so the next go over on this one is pretty much completed, and I can come back additionally after that. We've got a recessed area here, quickly with the line work. The magic of what line does, thick and thin, light and dark, where you choose and selectively work your line to pop it off the page. Okay, so let me go back to my drawing here. And I'll start right here with the ear on this side. Bring it down on the page for the camera. So you can see some shadow area here. I went a little bit heavier over here through selection of the ear, and I actually have a little bit more definition here, kicking the ear back a little bit like this as well too. Now remember what I said, this ear itself is higher up on the page, and as you look at the preliminary drawing, I've got the interior showing of that ear. Angle is this way, sensibility, we're seeing part of the inside of the ear. A couple of strokes here that just kind of secure it to the skull there. Then we've got the energy once again in terms of what's happening with the mane. Notice a little bit darker here with the ink marks. Okay, let's darken that. And then let's just pull back this way and make some selection as to what lines are going to be a little bit heavier in the mane. I want to now reconfigure where the strength of the line is on that jaw area. So with the ochre, I came in as I was sketching. It was a little far in, but this could be make a nice reflected shadow area there as well too. So what I'm doing here is I'm pulling in here, doing a little bit of adjustment now, okay? Pull this down here, starts to move out this way. In my mind, as I'm looking at this, I place, after drawing for all the years that I have, I automatically place a grid system across whatever I'm looking at in terms of reference. And with my students, one of the things that I do is I have them work a project where they use a grid system, because the old masters, Da Vinci and others, did this as well too, is they would do a small drawing, but then if you're dealing with a mural work, oversized scale on a canvas, whatever it is, you want to blow it up, well, they didn't have projectors as we have today. So they would do a grid system over the top of a smaller sketch, and if they were going very large, as opposed to 1 inch by 1 inch segment squares, you blow it up where it's 1 foot by 1 foot, and it immediately becomes massive. But then all you do is you follow the grid system. So what I'm saying to you is, whenever I look at source material, if it's in nature, I'm looking at someone to do a portrait, or doing a drawing of a drawing, I'm looking and I'm seeing a grid system consistently. What's high, what's low, what's the spacing, what's a positive, negative space. So after years of drawing, and my students find this to be true as well too, the more you draw, the more that grid system tends to pop up in your mind, in your inner vision, inner eye, so to speak, as you're drawing, and you see the relationships between things, and you can do comparatives. Now that mouth. This is recessed, okay, bring it over here a little bit farther so you can see it. This is recessed, so I'm going in a little bit deeper with that brown, okay. What's happening in here, you probably actually see the tongue from the angle that we have there as well too. So if it were a painting where I'm doing full color, or if I work this out completely in full color pencil, what I would be doing is showing a little pink for the tongue, etc. So you see a little detailing that way. A couple of strokes this way, the chest area is coming down this way, and then what we do, notice where it comes in terms of relationship of the mouth. I'm wrapping this thing down, some strong line this way, muscle once again, nice powerful strokes down here as we begin that leg mass on the horse, and then this is actually coming down here once again into the chest. I'm going to do a little bit dark here, and I'm just going to layer in maybe a little bit stronger this way as well too. So the treatment is, we're selecting certain areas. We're now creating a little bit more depth with it simply because of the play of light and dark. Staying loose too. What you can see is I like to rotate with the marks. I like to feel the strength of what the object is, if it's a horse, if it's a tiger, if it's a whatever from nature. I want to communicate that to myself and to the viewer with the line as well too. So here we are structuring here. Flare out here a little bit. Once again, we've got some additional lines here. And I'm coming down here, down to the snout as well too. Let's go up to the eye. I'm going to sharpen this for a second. And the eye, just like over here, let's do a little selection and let's go a little bit deeper in shadow area here. And let's just show a little bit more of the form as well too. Now with the eye, depending on the angle and the socket, you might possibly have a little more information up this way as well too. I've got a little bit of the forehead separation, which you'll see in horses as well too. And when they change, just slightly rotating, you're going to see a different change in terms of what your configuration of the form is going to be. I'm going to give a little bit more form off to the side like this. Okay, so he's kind of roughed in there. If I want to continue here and flare back a little bit more with these towards this horse this way for a balance and a direction, then I can do that. I can pull down this mane a little bit further and flare it into this one. So we kind of are working the two together now in terms of communicating here. And selectively, I can do more in the center here in terms of form as well too. I'll move over to the next one now. So let me go over here and get the next sketch. So this is, once again, side view of the horse. We started side here. We change the angle here, we're going to another profile over here on this side as well too. Once again, take a look at the line width as well too. There's actually reflected light up around the eye on this one, reflected light here underneath the jaw. I communicate this to myself even when I'm doing the pen and inks. I'll leave some spacing that tells me if you ever paint it later, you get more specific in a drawing. What I'm doing is laying that out for myself to follow as well too. So what I've got here is I've got more strength in terms of the dark for one of these ears, and then I've got strength of line and shadow area here. This is going to be an area around the socket of the eye of the horse here. rough that in a little bit more. Follow down here in terms of the strength of the front. And recessed area again too. Horses' nostrils are interesting. They change the slightest in terms of how they flare them, how open, how shut. They can just rotate the head a little bit. Nostrils going to look totally different. So if you're doing horses in particular, you will see a major change just in terms of that character or look of the nostril as they move from side to side. Coming under here, and once again, just get a little sketchy here. Let's go a little heavier in the line under here. I'll move my hand out of the way so you can see that. Then I'm going to go, and I'm going to flare this up a little bit, and then I'm going to come down into the jaw area like so. Here, let's go for that reflected light area, just laying that out for myself once again. Here is some definition. The horse, again, could be a solid color. Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. So what I'm communicating for myself here is literally, with this line, as simple as it is, this could be a change in terms of coloration on the horse itself, just by indicating that. I've been very loose up here in gesturing as well, too. Later on, I can communicate whether or not that's going to be part of the sheen on the horse as well, too. Let me do a couple of more lines here coming down into the nostril area. And on this one, maybe we'll just get a little bit deeper in terms of what happens here for the eye and kind of flare that out. I got some other details going here. Now, again, the strength here of the mane area, flow this down here. And again, depending on the particular horse, they may have a tremendously dramatic mane. So if the head goes forward, that may just kind of flow on down. And I just like to see the energy and the activity of this. So I'll just stay loose, wrap it around, wrap it around. Here is, just to show you, here once again is basically the neck configuration here. I'm going to come in here and then move out this way. And I think I'll put a rotation area here just to get some sense of energy off to the side here. Since I'm doing things of energy up here on the top of this mane, and oftentimes I'll do this. I'll communicate with line if I use line or drama in terms of the flow in one area of the composition. And again, I'm not doing it here because I'm sticking to Mr. Da Vinci over here. But in my own work, I'll flare this way, and then I'll come back to another area of the composition, and I'll just simply do the flare and do the rotation to kind of balance out between the areas as well, too. Okay, a few more things here. Now, let's see what else we could do. In terms of the horse itself, you could go in and you could lightly start to pencil in some areas of other value tones. So in other words, let's give this horse a little bit more strength on the page in terms of contrast. Okay, so we've got basically what amounts to the white, or the, in this case, the cream color or the wheat color here, but I can layer in some other strokes. So what I'm doing is I'm just communicating this has a little bit more form, mass, etc. on the page. Immediately, in a short amount of time, did a little more contrast between back of the page, the substrate, and the object that's being done, the subject that's being done. Do the same thing with the other horses. In the context of adding more volume as well too, you can then start to do some additional line work on that. And so I'll switch over here. Let me grab once again this one and put it on the page so you can see it. So what I'll do here is, and let me show you some erasing techniques. Now, you can use like a kneaded eraser, which is a very soft pliable eraser, just to talk about a couple other things. Everybody knows the good old pink pearl, which comes on the back of everybody's number two pencil. There it is, pink pearl. Can be used to work in and erase areas in a color pencil. So you can do some lifting with the pink pearl. Remember what I said is there's more wax content in the color pencil, unlike graphite. So it's a little bit tougher depending on your substrate to erase it. So you can use a hard pink pearl. In some cases when you want to soften an area, the kneaded eraser comes in a rectangular format. What this is, in difference to the pearl eraser, is if you're lifting graphite and doing a lot of removal, what you can do is you can take this and stretch it like silly putty. Have some fun with it. What it does is if you can see this on the camera, it's very, very small, but it's self-cleaning. It gets lighter because what you're doing is you're rotating the outer portion of it that has graphite or the waxy color pencil, and you're cleaning it. The other advantage of this is if you have softer graphite, you can't do it with the waxy color pencil, soft graphite is you can pinch the edge of this kneaded eraser and lift and pull and do very thin lines of removal with this. Or you can take this thing, flatten it out. Say if you're doing a sky and you want to take a big swipe and you want to remove a cloud area. Well, you can do that with the edge of the kneaded eraser. So it gives you the benefits, unlike a traditional eraser. So part of the tricks of the trades and tools of the trades, there's a couple of them there in terms of what they will do for you. The more you draw, the more you experiment, the more you're going to get acquainted with the variety of tools available to you. Sheer repetition. I tell my students this, and it's very simple. When you first were learning to write your name in block letters, you may have taken a fair amount of time. If you had a B or an S in your name, you may have had it reversed from what it should have been. Eventually, you can do the block lettering, no problem. Ultimately, you get into script, cursive, or whatever. You sign your name, you don't even think about it. So what took place? Sheer repetition over a period of time. I tell my students, what you want to do, continue to draw, and you get a to the point in time where you don't think about certain basics. You then move on to the complexities of the composition or the complexities of something you want to communicate to the viewer. So step by step, it gets more advanced. Phraseology I always use in the studio, and it makes sense. When you're developing an image, first bake the cake before you put any icing on it, which means get your foundation in there, make sure the proportions are correct, the composition's the way you want it, then you can detail the thing all day long. Don't get ahead of yourself and try to be too advanced and find out I've got to erase or remove all this because the basic proportions weren't working. So take the time to do that. Later on, all the icing, all the candles, whatever you want to put on the cake, do it later, okay? So there's a little baking lesson along with the art. We'll toss that in there too. Okay, so on this horse here, going to give it a little bit more substance as well too, under here, and I'll do a little line work that's under the nostril down here as well too. And I'm going to bring a little something in here. With the mane, I'm going to start to just position in a little more value tone this way as well too. The play of light and dark. Now there might be a little bit of reflected light and sheen on the mane up there as well too. In here, a little bit more detailing. Then I'll come back to this one. So I just want to wrap this drawing up, but you've seen the process and the thinking in terms of what it takes and what Da Vinci did to structure a notebook page or do preliminaries. Now there might be a time in terms of what you do with the composition. This might work dramatically well for a painting, and you might want to go on to a finished painting just off of what you did with the sketch. So this horse as well too, I'm just going to come in here, I'm going to structure a little bit more value tone on this just to give it a little bit more strength on the page. I'll come under the neck area here, a little more value tone here. Give myself an opportunity for maybe some reflected light under there too. Now, once again, with this neck area too, if I want to, and I want to communicate the volume a little bit more, on this particular drawing, I've got a light area there that might be a sheen on the back of the neck. But just to show you, with the curvature situation, to define it, since we know it is dimensional, when you draw this, you might actually want to do some line work that communicates how that neck wraps around. So what I'm doing in the language of art is I'm showing some of the form as it wraps around like this. Let's toss in a little bit of this golden ochre down here in terms of what's happening there, and maybe some motion line work as well too. And then let's just go ahead and we'll pull this up here a little bit farther. Okay, stop here. So let's take a look at the page. Finished page, communicated enough to myself or the viewer in terms of composition, in terms of a sense of the form, the line quality, the thick and thin, areas where we can do reflected light, etc. There is some drama in terms of what takes place in the V, okay? There is drama in terms of what takes place here with the rotation of the heads. There are different angles positioned across the composition as well, too. So you look at the whole page, how does it set up? Are you pleased with it? If not, you can do some additional adjustment as well, too. So there we have a lesson in terms of looking at Da Vinci's horses and composing on a page. And that, more or less, is how it's done, step by step. Now, in the next segment, what I'd like to do is I'd like to do a portrait, and what I'm going to do is take one of Da Vinci's figureheads, and we'll set aside the horses. I'll get a fresh sheet here, and I'm going to show you a figurehead of Da Vinci's, and again, preliminary piece that was done, but I'm going to talk about what you do in terms of structuring a portrait and how you get the look of a portrait on a page. When you're going for a portrait, I'm going to show you something off to the side here first, very loosely. When you're doing a portrait, let me show you this. I'll go right into a sepia so you can see this very, very well. A lot of times with portraits, you will have basically four head shapes. The most common one usually is what's called the egg shape. So there it is, okay? If you have a young child, the young child normally, when you think about a baby in particular, now this is dramatizing it, but a young child does not have angular features, is not strong in what's taking place with the chin, is more round and soft all the way around. When you're doing a child, oftentimes you would start with a shape that basically is very, very round. Now there are shapes of heads sometimes that are more rectangular, squared this way. Occasionally, you will have the shape of a head that may actually look this way. Now, when you're doing a portrait, it's up to you to make the decision. Once again, looking at the most basic shape, which one of those figureheads is closest? You're going to be altering because I'm going to show you where you put ears, eyes, etc. to get a likeness. That's going to vary from time to time depending on who the individual is. Here, even neck sizes, when you draw a neck too, you can indicate maybe whether or not it's a heavy, light person, etc. And when you draw too, even the neck area, when we talk about drawing, I'm going to draw the basic 4 to 5 shapes that I give my students all the time. Cylinder shape, okay? There's also cube shape. So you start basically with square, and then to go dimensional, you just bring that back and you've gone 3D in terms of a cube. If you add directional light to any of these, what takes place is you're going to have cast shadow, and the magic of art is all of a sudden this thing is going to start to get three-dimensional on the page. It's the same way with the cylinder. If you were to cast shadow off of the cylinder, it starts to get 3D. And I'm going to go on and I'll show you the next one that you can do is cone situation. Okay, and we have the sphere as well too. I'll use this for the sphere. So if we have directional lighting this way, you're going to have strength of shadows. You may have a highlight on this. You'll have a cast shadow area here. And wonder of wonders, if it's a bowling ball, if it's going to be a piece of fruit, whatever it is, it's going to start to pop off the page. So same way with the cone. Now as you look at the cone, it is very similar. That's why I say 4 to 5 shapes. Is you could also think in terms of the pyramid. Pyramid and cone, very similar, obviously, in terms of shape. So there's your 4 basic or 5 shapes that you can be utilizing in terms of structuring something in nature, still life, portrait, etc. Now, with the figurehead that I have here of Da Vinci's work, what I'm going to do is show you the fact that when you're starting a drawing, this female figurehead, if viewed straight on, basically is going to be the oval situation here. If I were drawing her straight on, as you see it here, division line, center line, guidelines, okay? And I go through this in depth with all my students when we do portraiture. Oversized this way. The eyes, for the most part, are usually about halfway down the skull area. The nose and the mouth may roughly be positioned here, depending again on the individual features. The eye, straight on, you can start with almond shape, but you can alter that obviously as well too. But usually the distance between the eyes is one eye width, okay? Not a whole lot of detail yet. So you may add brows, and the brows may be high. If we're doing a female form, maybe they're high. They might be a little bit lighter like this. Nose area as well too is coming down here. So shape of the nose, it could be broad, it could be narrow, etc. Lip area here, what we're doing is just using that center guideline, getting the lips in. There might be a little bit recessed shadow area underneath here. Maybe cheekbones might be high up here as well too. We sketch that in. Notice what I didn't do yet in terms of the detailing is I stayed away from the hair. And there's a reason for that, is you want to have the skull area completed before you put the hair on top. You have to have the source. If the hair is parted in the middle, and it may come down over the eyes like this, but you're drawing the hair above the skull, and it may flare as well too. The eyes, again, depending on the individual, they might be equal with the eye where the ear is on both sides. So you would structure the ears here. After you've got the figurehead sketched in, maybe there might be hoop earrings, okay? So there might be some type of area there with the neck area for necklace or whatever. Think 3D, think transparent, translucent. When you're drawing something, try to think as though it were glass or plexiglass. You can see all the way through it, so you're not just thinking flat, you're going all the way to the back and you're thinking about the full volume, about what this is and the space that it occupies. When you're doing still life, you have to think in the volume that way to have one object actually breathing and existing next to another object instead of scrunching them together. You have to think that way. So if we have a necklace here, the necklace may be two or three portions or whatever, so it may wrap around the neck area this way, but then we might have some other additional necklaces that come down here. And let's just alter here. We can make the mouth a little bit darker. We can start to, once again, we can detail in nostrils as well too. Once we've got that in, remember what I did with the sphere up here, directional lighting. If I have lighting coming from here underneath the chin, and I can have a little bit of reflected light over here on the side, you're coming down here, and what am I doing? I'm blocking in some shadow area that's going to start to give her some depth, okay? I'll complete the hair here, and whatever the design might happen to be. There might be some hair that comes down behind here as well too. But then we get in here, and just like when I was doing the horses, maybe we'll go a little bit heavier in terms of the top of the eye here, so that we have some dimension in terms of the eye socket. You can always go in and you can detail the eyebrows more as well too. So step by step by step. What do I have? The basic foundation, then the details go on top. So this is what I'm showing here. The angle of the light comes here, then more than likely we're going to have more cast shadow. We'll have deeper value tone off to the side here with the hair as well too. And we might have some area that falls more into shadow here because we've got light against dark, a few flyaways this way, okay? And you can see step by step. So what happens? The drama, starting with a very basic and then building out from there. There is a process. What I teach all the time is art systems. I tell my students, foundation, foundation, foundation. Always, there's a step-by-step process, and there's a reason for what I'm doing with each particular assignment. Now, back to Mr. Da Vinci. So, now what's taking place here? I'm going to do this quickly. She is looking straight on, and that's why I wanted to tell you about looking straight on. I'm going to do the oval again. If it rotates, or if the individual is looking off three-quarter view, what happens to the center line that I did? The center line now rotates to the side of the head. If the head were looking down, like in the case with horses or some other sketches I've done, if it's looking down, what takes place is those lines for the, think of this as an egg with lines on it. The lines for the eyes, for the nose, for the mouth are going to curve around, and we're basically looking at the top of the skull. We're now looking down in terms of getting the illusion of 3D on this particular figurehead. So there's the difference there. We're still going to have 3D in the neck, et cetera, and build on that. With Mr. Da Vinci's piece now, I'm going to lightly work this in. I'll do it with a brown pencil to begin with, but I'm going to start and I'm going to go, and I'm looking at what's taking place just in terms of light line with this figurehead and the way this goes back in space here. This is up a little bit higher in the back here, but I'm looking to see how much I have to do in terms of curvature, kind of searching this thing out, looking at the angle here, see if I have to adjust that, searching it out. And what takes place here is we've got quite a bit of open forehead on the top with a few lines this way, okay? And I'm coming down here, and what we're going to see in the back area here is we're going to see some of his line work, the directional stroke for someone that's left-handed. Then I'm coming down here, and just like the horse, there is, when we're coming down into the eye socket area, ever so subtle, there is a little bit of bump out where the eye is. I'm looking at the contour. So before really doing details here, I'm starting to search out the contour, just the edge, and I'm going to do this for you. What I'm looking at is this, 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 and this. See the line? That's what I'm looking at. I'm looking at the rhythm of the line, what's taking place as I'm coming down the edge and then pulling it in. And what I want to do is see roughly where I'm going to be by the time I need to get to the chin area. I can readjust that just like I did with the horses. Little bit of an eyebrow area here. Now with this eye, there's a recessed area. We've got a nose that's going to be coming down here. We've got an eye that is looking out this way. And we've got a little bit of indication underneath here as well too. Over here, just softly working this in, and I'm looking for the depth of what the nose would be here. So what I'm looking at too, as I'm drawing this, I'll sharpen my pencil a second, is I'm looking at what takes place in terms of the nose this way, and how it bumps out just a little bit and then comes down here. It doesn't break the area on the side of the figurehead. So I'm coming back here and I'm looking at how narrow this is with the bridge area and just kind of searching this thing out. Now again, what I can do is quick lines here, and I can look at where my center line is and where it's going to be for working for the mouth in here as well too, and what's going to take place with that. So I'm structuring here and I'm structuring underneath here. I've got some shadow area that's here. I may be doing some adjustment. And what takes place is here, this eye is recessed in a little bit. We've got some highlight up there. And I might use the white on this one to kind of show what's taking place in terms of the play of light and dark in the recessed areas. And what I've done here is I start to put in the eyes. I may do some adjustment there. But I'm starting to get the look of the area of the eye that's recessed. I'll come up a little bit higher with this eyebrow area here, since he has light above, and it's fairly strong in terms of the weight here above the eye. And so I'm coming in here and under here, and I'm looking at some of these shadow areas. I'm just going to scout out these areas. I'm going to drop in some more shadow area here as well too. Then I'll take a look at it and see if I need to soften or readjust anything as well too. Taking a look at the eyes across this way. This eye could be a little bit higher in relationship to that, so I'll make the adjustment. And we're going to see a little bit of the top of the eyelid here, and then that'll come up here. So I'll make an adjustment on that, and then continue to come down here as well too. So softness here. There's going to be some form that's going to be here in terms of the cheek area. So I'll make some adjustment here in terms of what takes place coming down here and how much we see in terms of the chin area before it starts to shoot back here towards the hair as well too. Now, interesting in terms of what takes place here, the line work under the nose is coming down here. We've got some of the chiaroscuro. We got some of that play of light and dark on the eye, or excuse me, on the nose area of the eyes as well too, in terms of the recessed. So as I work around and sketch a little bit more, maybe I'll do a little bit more refinement that way. But what I'm going to find here is I want to start to get a little bit particular in terms of the angle of the mouth and the way that curves up and the distance between the mouth area there to the side as well too. We're going to have some more form that's going to be underneath here, okay? There's going to be a little bit of curvature up on the edge here as well too. Under the nose, I'll pull the nose in a little bit, but we do have some shadow area that's going to be underneath the nose as well too. So step by step by step, and what I'm doing here is I'll search out, and with Da Vinci, of course, the line is this way. I'm right-handed, he's left-handed, but still doing the directional stroke as to how he's formulated this, and in this particular piece as well too. Let me go back to racing situation in here, and then I can start to rotate out and lift some of that line work as well too for the adjustment. So you have to get in there, and if you have to lift some of your preliminary line, go in, lift that, adjust that as well too. We'll be adjusting the width of what we have over there as well too. So back here, working the chiaroscuro a little bit more, this is going to be a little bit heavier this way. The eye is really kind of gazing off into the direction a little bit further this way and kind of looking down a little bit as well too. So we'll make adjustments on that as we go along. And then on the edge of the eye, we've got a pretty strong shadow here in terms of what takes place there as well too. Sharpen the pencil again. Here, coming down between the center area here, I'm looking for the adjustment here, and what I'll do is erase out a little bit here in terms of the separation that's taking place there as well. Okay, so I've got a little bit of the play of the mouth this way, okay? Direction of the eye, I'm going to go a little bit deeper here in terms of the shadow area here that's close to the nose. And then over here, just to start laying this out, so we got a few flyaways of the hair. He's got some line work that's here as well too. Then when he gets up here, we got a lot of directional stroke. I'm just going to rough this in quickly. Notice what he did here on the hair. As I pull this down a little bit closer, reflected light right here. He's going to go pretty strong between the light against dark and how this starts to work here. So what I'm going to do is kind of lay this in for you. I'm going to maintain a highlight area in here. I can come back with the white and even dramatize that all the more. But let's get some directional strokes in here. What appears to be with this lady is she may possibly be wearing some type of head wrapping, because what we see here is something that's coming down over the figurehead, down here and up here. And with preliminary sketches, it may not be that detailed. Remember the general specific that's taken place. This eye to me is starting to look a little like Mona Lisa, but we'll pull it off to the side here a little bit more. So here is, we're going a little bit more deep in terms of the shadow area here. We also have the line work casting to the side as well too. What takes place here is he's given us some information in terms of the lower lip area. And so I'm going to structure some of that in, highlights on the lip, and he's gone a little bit stronger here. We're giving some definition as we're working here now, is definition in terms of the form under the chin and the chiaroscuro, the play of the light and dark. I'll dramatize a little bit more with some strokes here as we come down the side this way. And that itself now starts to pop the image off of the page a little bit more. With the neck area, look at the neck in terms of relationship to where the eye is, where this eyeball is here. If you followed it down on an angle, the neck area for the few strokes that he has are kind of coming in this particular area. The direction of the chin as well too, as I look at this, is more or less right about here. See how I tightened it up? When I first started, now take a look at this, notice this. I'm searching it out. Look how far down I came with the jaw, because I wasn't sure what I'm going to do proportion with it. I know I want to get to the point in time where it properly relates, but I've brought the jaw up a couple different times. So in the refinement process, I get closer and closer to what is happening with the original. and what's going on with the play of light and dark in portions of it as well too. And we're going to see that we've got an area that's underneath the eye here that's in shadow area as well too. This is going to come over here and up here a little bit more. So looking off there to the side, a little bit darker in the area here. I'll resharpen again. Sketching it through, okay? He has some strokes that continue this way, maybe for just what I did here on the dramatization of structuring is we've got some cast shadow areas, so he's drawing and just showing some directional line this way as well too. So all the way up through here, same way with the drawing here. Now where this is in relationship to the nose, I'm going to shoot across the nose up this way on an angle. This will probably come down just a little bit more there. So I'd adjust down there. He's got a little stronger line there, etc. We've got that flyaway line. So we're basically working the play of light and dark this way, and bringing the nose down a little bit more recessed this way as well too. And in the eye area, I'll start to give a little bit more definition here on that one. And this, the eye gets fairly heavy in terms of what's happening with the shadow area. There is a little indication here in terms of some form on the side of the mouth and then going up here into the cheek area. There's a few lines that are here. There's some very soft shadowing area, you may or may not see it on the camera, that is here as well too. So as we're looking here, I've given her a gaze, I can readjust the eyes some more, but I've given her a gaze that's kind of looking out at you, the viewer, as you look at these eyes. Okay, so we've sketched in the chiaroscuro, and let me do this. This is sfumato. This is the Italian term for the very soft play of light and dark that Da Vinci did. Chiaroscuro, also done by Da Vinci, but in particular, the master in history of this would be Rembrandt and Caravaggio. This is a very strong manipulation of the play of light and dark, so things really pop off the canvas and come towards you. And it's taken from basically the Italian, the old master terminology, which is chiaro here, which is light, scuro, obscure, which is dark. And remember when I showed you, and I'll just reach over here quick, going all the way back to the basics, the play of light and dark. That's the only way you're ever going to get three-dimensionality on a two-dimensional surface is to understand that value scale, if it's done in black and white, if it's done in sepia tone, if it's done in full color as well too. So just quickly, this is an overview in terms of what's taking place to structure what I did in the very beginning segment, which is to do the full montage, little pieces of what was involved in bringing the sum total together. I hope you enjoyed all these segments. Hope it was very informative to you. Hope to see a number of you in the classroom. I've enjoyed all the instruction that I've done and the tremendous talent that I've seen at Valencia College over the years. Tremendously impressive to me. So, start out, do your research, choose a particular culture history that really impacts you for whatever reason. It could be ancient, it could be modern culture. Structure it, understanding that you'll be including a portrait, figure, landscape, still life item in a montage, multiple image, vignette softening out to the side. So that basically wraps it up here for today. Hope you enjoyed the segments, and we'll probably be talking to some of you independently. Thanks again. This is Gary Lessard.